Thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, it's a pleasure.
And sorry if you don't understand my English for some reason, please just ask to repeat something that you don't understood.
Okay, great. Yeah, no, I'm sure you'll be great. But yeah, thank you. Okay, Matt, are you all ready with the live stream?
Good to go. We're live.
Okay.
Yeah, avatar won't fly, but it's back there, so it's fine.
Oh, let me. Do you want me to fix that real quick?
Can if you can turn it on for me, I'll fly them.
Yeah, give me 2 seconds. I'm gonna fix it.
Okay.
Yeah, I found the exact problem. What do you think, Matt? Are we ready?
Good to go.
Good to go. Okay, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Marco, who is going to introduce our speaker for tonight.
So thank you, everyone, for being here. This is the last event for today in the official agenda of XR Safety Week 2021, Day 3. Then we will have two more events on YouTube organized by VR Spawn, so one of our partners for gaming and for, how could I say, a gaming culture. But before getting there, we want to take you this evening in a place in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. We will fly to Cape Verde or Cape Verde with Gonzalo Prates. I met him, yeah, when was it, Gonzalo? Was it in June, if I'm not wrong?
Yes.
And we were discussing about this project of bringing an immersive laboratory in this country, in this African country in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. And yeah, as far as I know, things are evolving quite smoothly. So Gonzalo, your turn to close the official program of Day 3 of XR Safety Week. And thank you everyone for being here with us this tonight again.
Thanks a lot, everyone, to joining me. This is my first Altspace presentation. So
hold on 1 second. It seems like your audio is not being amplified, so let me fix that really quick.
All right.
Hey, Marco, can you help with this? I unfortunately can't amplify him for some reason.
I'm taking care of it.
Okay, I just amplify my voice. I don't know if it
perfect.
Worked or
that's
not.
That's it. Thank you so much. All right, now please go ahead.
Okay, here in the host tools. Okay, so it is my first time in Altspace, but I think this is quite easy to use. So. And thank you very much for having me. As Marco told, I'm speaking from the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. I'm right now in Praia City in Cape Verde, which is an African country. You will see here the location. We can go to the next slide. So my name is Gonçalo Prates. I'm a little bit more ugly than my avatar, And my nationality is Portuguese, but I live in Cape Verde for 10 years. I worked for Siemens, Nokia Siemens, and I founded here MGO Consulting, which is a technology consulting company. And I'm an XR enthusiast and self-learner, so everything I know about XR is self-learning, as most of the people right now. Next. So a little bit of geolocation. So Cape Verde is here, okay? And the nearest country from the African continent is Senegal. And we are an island, but separated by thousands of kilometers. So from the bottom to the top is more or less 1.5 hours of plane. Okay, so it's not too it's far away from each of the islands. Okay, so in order just to understand why this project makes sense. So the next the nearest museums or the nearest city is Dakar, which is more or less 45 minutes by plane, and it costs a minimum of $300 per person. So when we are talking about field trips, students' field trips, you see that there are no students' field trips because of the high costs of the traveling. And even inside the archipelago, even from island to island, most of the people and even students don't know other islands, okay? Because the cost of the traveling between islands is it's expensive also. So here students don't do field trips. Even before COVID-19, they don't do it. So one thing that we thought about is, can virtual reality simulate a field trip? Yeah, I think it can simulate. It's not the same thing, but it can simulate. So we decided to analyze how to do it, how to bring immersive technologies to provide the students here from a school, which is the Portuguese school in Cape Verde, a way to more or less travel to other places. We started to talk with the manager of the school, and as soon as we put the headset in her head and put the simple 360 video of an experience to going from with a air balloon from ground to space, she realized the potential that this kind of technologies could have for the students. And so we started to understand how we could get funding and how to build how to build this from scratch. And it was when I decided to enter in this technology and started to study everything I could get about this technology. So what was the challenges that we face? First challenge was to choose the right hardware. So as you know, most of you know, we have two main types of hardware. One is standalone, like Oculus Quest I'm using right now, and the other one is tethered. So you need a gaming PC, and it's very expensive. And with the standalone, we have limited runtime because it runs on batteries and it's hard to manage. So you don't see what the students are seeing. So it's a little bit hard to manage. Okay. So now the second challenge was how to choose the right software. Okay, we needed two types of softwares, one to do device management and another one to do content managers, because we decided that the main technology that we were using was the standalone headsets. Okay. And we started to search in the industry what kind of software would we use for this project. And the existing device management software was not made for headsets at the time. And the devices were seen as any other device. Right now, there are at least two or three companies that already make a specific device management products for this kind of devices. But at the time when we started there was no one. Another one is content management. So the existing content management solutions are focused on 360 video and need installation of client APKs, and need to upload the content to the content management platform, and don't support existing content solutions like YouTube, or don't support WebXR. So this was the second challenge that we had, because we needed to have a simple solution to use. We need to have a solution that a teacher could easily learn and could easily send content to the headsets without even the students had to understand how the operating system of the headset works. So the third challenge was choose the right content. So we then identified three kinds of content. One is the 360 video. Another one was native applications, and the third one was WebXR. So the 360 video was complex to do, okay, because you need to have special 360 cameras, it's expensive, and there is no standard quality yet. Okay, you could have videos with very good quality, the other ones don't have so much quality. But has advantages of supported low power devices, so you don't need too much CPU or too much power from the device to run the video, and there is a good availability. Already can find good content to show to the student. Native apps are complex to build, so some of you know that it's not easy to make an application for WebXR. Needs installation, needs user training. Okay, there is a standard quality, but it's complex to manage. So you need an external solution to manage the applications that are installed in the devices. Then we have the WebXR. It's, for me, it's still in the experimental phase because you cannot do the same experiences as native apps. And it's not interoperable yet. So if you go from one technology to another one, you don't have compatibility yet. And it's a little bit complex of managing, because you need to type the URLs of the experiences, and normally you need to teach the students to use a virtual keyboard. It for younger ones could not be too easy to do. The advantage is that you have one version to devices. So since we had experience application development, so web application development, we decided to build our own solutions to manage everything. So this is why we decided to do it. There was no it was a limited standalone enterprise hardware availability. So the normally the solutions only supported one kind of devices. No easy to use device management, no easy to use content management, different content management for different content types. So we had, for instance, applications that manage video but and don't manage the APKs, and the other ones that manage the installation of applications but don't manage 360 video. And so WebXR requires URL typing, as I told you. YouTube also requires URL typing if you want to go to a specific video. And almost all of them needs you to teach at least the minimum for someone interact with the immersive operating system of the devices. So for younger students, it would be difficult to do this kind of experience. So why this is a slide showing why we decided to go mostly for standalone devices, so, because it's the trend right now. That's why we adopted to go with Oculus Quest 2 and Pico Neo 3. As you will see in the next slides. So what we are doing right now, we are finishing the software, okay? So we joined both of the solutions with an MDM and CMS. So it's a mobile device management and the content management system is a proposed build customizable for this one. It's a cloud-based multi-vendor support, easy to use content management, mixing between device management and content management, and supports all type of content. So we can support WebXR, video, images, YouTube, Vimeo, audio, messaging, and customized application actions. So we can send any command from the web, from this application to the devices without user intervention. So some key features, auto-enrollment, firewall agnostic, so you don't need to change anything in your network. Simple and customizable user interface. You can monitor the device, remote device control, inventory, multi-user, multi-vendor, grouping, and playlist. So just to highlight some of the features that we needed to understand, to create, and some use cases. So since we have the possibility to send any kind of content to a group of devices from anywhere, okay, for education and training, the teachers can use this to send, for instance, a YouTube video for all the devices at the same time, or open an application in all the devices in the room, open a WebXR application all at the same time for all the devices. So we needed this tool in order to create the possibility to the teachers use the system without having to train the students. So the idea is the students, they seated in chairs, and then the teacher with two or three clicks in the mouse in our platform send the content to the devices that are in that room. But this also works in the cloud, so you could do this with a device in any country in the world. So for marketing and events, we can distribute the content to group of devices, whatever country it is, for apps and product showcases, and for WebXR showcases also. You can send open URL in a browser from anywhere to any place. So this was the main idea, was to have a VR showcase with some standalone devices, but we realized that was interesting to have also some kind of laboratory, and we extended the solution to other kind of more advanced devices in order for the students and teachers could create their own content and could share the content to others. So the complete hardware will be Oculus Quest 2 and Pico Neo 3 for 15 users, PC-based VR with full body tracking and facial tracking, some ultraviolet UGM cleaning, of course, 8K 360 video camera, an iPad for photogrammetry, dedicated 12 terabyte storage to storage the projects. From software point of view, we will need Adobe Cloud for 360 video and image editing. Unity, we are partnering with a Russian company, which is called Varwin. It has a block-based development solution, so you don't need to program anything. You just have some blocks, and you can put all the rules just with blocks, and automatically the applications are generated. For collaboration solution, we will use Engage VR and also Space for sure, but Engage VR has possibility to record in 360 and in 3D all the lectures, so it's easier for the teachers to create content for the students. And for sure, anyone that wants to participate, we are open to have all kind of solutions that can enhance the lab and the project. So what is our mission? We have now it's to be the first R&D lab in Africa that enables free access to immersive technology. So anyone that wants to join us could start developing their solutions here and use every hardware. Okay, we will have internships available and partnerships with universities. So if you know anyone interested in coming here for internships, give the possibilities to students from these and other schools to experience immersive technology for the first time. So the idea of the manager of the school is to also extend this project to the most schools in the country. So even students from other schools could visit this school and make experiences as a social way to deliver something for the society. And so we will be the catalyst for inclusion and all of every all the community. And so also we want to have the possibility to enable students for content creation that can be shared with other students and the rest of the immersive technology community. So one of the ideas of using the Varwin solution was they have worldwide hackathons. So students that use their platform can share their projects with other students from other countries and have hackathons between countries, which is very interesting to do. And so, as I told, we want to be the catalyst for new forms of communication and students' engagement and inclusion. It's not mentioned here, but we did a nice project also, using a social platform called Mozilla Hubs. I don't know if some of you already heard about. The idea was, and why we used Mozilla Hubs, because it is a web-based, it's like Altspace, but it's web-based. You don't need to install anything. And the idea was to give the possibility to the parents visit the school in times of COVID that the school was closed. And right now the school closed last week because of it again. And the parents can go to this webpage and visit the school in 3D environment. Because we digitalized, we made a digital twin of the school. And instead of having a normal hotspot 360 image journey, you can walk around with your avatar inside the school and enter in the rooms to see how the rooms are and in real visit the school. So as you see this, we have the luck to have a management that understood the concept of immersive technologies, and she understood that this is the future and accepted all our ideas. And we didn't see this, for instance, in other schools, even in Portugal, that we started to contact some of the schools, and there is not this kind of openness. Okay, so I think for me that's it. It's already late for Europeans, and it's still in the early for Americans. But this was the message that I wanted to share with you. I don't know if you like it. If you have any questions, you can chat a little bit for right now.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. Let's give a little bit of, I'm trying to get my emoji wheel up. Applause. That was a wonderful presentation, and it's really interesting to hear how you've been able to use this technology in such an engaging way for these kids. So it's really amazing. Lovely to see your work. Does anybody have questions? We have a couple of minutes. I know, as long as you're okay, I know it's late your time. Are you okay to answer a few questions?
Yeah, for sure. No problem.
Sure. Okay, great.
Everyone is asleep right now. So.
Well, we appreciate you being here so late. Okay, great. Rami, give me 1 second. I'm going to amplify your mic. Can you go ahead and unmute yourself for me? I swear I know how to do this. Here we go. Okay, Rami, as soon as you unmute yourself, you're welcome to ask your question.
I'm on. Could you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. Yes. What age is the school having the kids? Because you said students, but you already didn't hear what age you started doing this. And in what of the islands, you have this school? I have some relatives in Cape Verde. So I am in USA. I live in USA, but I have relatives in Cape Verde. So maybe they can go and learn something in that school.
Thank you very much for the questions. The school is a K-12 school, so from but here it's a little bit different. It's from kindergarten, so from 3 years old until 18 years old. So we have a K-12, but with kindergarten mixed in the same school. We are in Praia, in Santiago Island. Is it the same?
That's phenomenal. So you're using the VR on all the students from K-12?
The project is on it's not finished yet. It's not still on
Great.
We started the project right now, so we started to buy the hardware, okay. But the idea is to have at least to 10 years old, I think is the minimum, until 18 years old.
That's great. All right, do we have any other questions? You can just use that little hand raise emoji. Okay, Marco, you have a question. Great, please. I think you know how to megaphone yourself.
Yeah, Gonzalo, a question regarding the specific context of Cabo Verde and the possibility to expand this project. I mean, Cabo Verde has a very specific specific conditions where you can work, or do you think this project can be a pilot for other countries in the region?
Yes, the idea is that is to have a pilot project and to show that it's possible to do this kind of project. It's not too expensive as you might expect, we want to study the impact that this will take in the society, and to don't have any possibility to do field trips, to have this kind of technology to know other places. Okay, so I think this could be used as a pilot project for other countries also.
Especially maybe starting from the other PALOP countries and then moving to other language groups.
I think it's easier to have English-speaking countries, because one of our difficulties is to have content in Portuguese.
So, okay, sure.
I think it's easier to have some English-speaking students to start using this kind of technology, because most of the experiences are in English. So we will have to understand how can we translate or dub some of the experiences that need dubbing, or to make our own experiences.
Thank you. Amazing. All right. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you so much for rounding out our final with the final talk of our midweek safety week. It's been a tremendous amount of fun to be here with you and all of our speakers. Mark will be sending out a replay of a recap of today's events. So if you're signed up on the xrsafetyweek.org email mailing list, you get a link to all of the YouTube channels, live streams from earlier in the day. And we have all 3 days so far as talks have been live streamed and recorded. So if you've missed any of them, you'll still be able to catch them. And we just thank you so much for joining, and hope to see you back here tomorrow at 9 a.m. Pacific. We have a full day of medical XR talks, and we're super excited about it. So Marco, I'll hand it over to you if you want to say any final words, and then encourage people to either hang out here or in the courtyard.
Yeah, very quickly. The official agenda is closing right now, but in 22 minutes, we have another community event starting. So go on youtube.com/vrespawn. Or go to xrsafetyweek.org. In the agenda, you can find two events from our partner VR Respawn and from our great community partner, Vivian Chazen. They will be talking about equal opportunities in gaming, discrimination, and so on. So there will be a very amazing and enjoying conversations within and for, but not only, the gaming community. So have a great rest of the day and a great night if you are in Europe like me. So I will go take some sleep. Let's start again tomorrow. Tschüssi.